Lewis, and good morning everyone, and in the next 6 minutes we'll cover a 20-minute talk. The one thing worse than being the last speaker in the session is to have a hypoglycemic audience. So please bear with me. My office and labs are 200 metres that way. It's the School of Veterinary Medicine. However, more than 50% of my research group are human MDs. We do most of our work in human tissues or human cells. We don't have experimental animals, we have non-human patients. So actually, one of the comments there, some people do want to cure cancer in rats. However, we're all mammals. I'm going to concentrate on reproducibility in the sense that you have it clearly highlighted here in terms of safety science. And reproducibility is quite interesting. We assume in laboratories, say in a diagnostic laboratory, that you need reproducibility. If you take a measurement of cholesterol over a period of time, you really want things to be tight. And that's not always the case for laboratories in which we're doing blue sky type activities. We don't know what to expect. And reproducibility, of course, is not ideal. If we've got a flawed experiment or flawed conclusion, reproducibility is actually very, very bad. Morris alluded to three levels of discovery pathways in his introduction. One was what I call blue skies research, where ideas, where we use archives, to generate hypotheses which can be taken to the next stage, which is translational type of research, going towards commercialization, which myopic governments keep telling us we've got to do, and some people do it very, very well. We've had some examples of that today. And the third stage is, as you see, I call it when the rubber hits the road, when applications are actually made. And the examples I'll use are largely from the life sciences and largely towards clinical or medical applications, but they're common to all of the activities that we use. And look, has anyone seen this paper before? Please raise your hands if you have. Oh, good. It caused a bit of concern about 10 years ago, but it was published in PLOS Medicine. And it's been cited over 1,500 times and blogged about 15 billion times. It generated a real interest. Why? Most published research findings are false. If you haven't read this, it's well worth reading it. It's actually well worth reading it more than once, and also following up in some of the conversations that it's generated. Is there a problem with early stage research? Well, here's another piece of data, which comes from the same journal, actually, and you can follow things like this on Retraction Watch. Some of us were talking about that website earlier. The total number of papers that have been published since about the 1970s increases at a roughly linear rate. Here we have an indication of the number of papers which have been retracted in red and in blue, which is increasing at a non-linear rate. And it's papers retracted in red for fraud and in blue for honest error, or something that couldn't be pinned down as fraud. So similar numbers. Are we getting better? No. There's a delay phase between publishing something and getting caught or dealing with it. So this is an issue which is pretty important. The reasons for retractions have been examined by a lot of people. This particular analysis indicates that breaks down over time. Those which were retracted because of fraud or suspected fraud, error, plagiarism, or duplication. And maybe it's not that surprising. And this analysis indicated that misconduct accounts for the majority of retractions. So there's something going on there. It's actually been dealt with quite well. I think the journals do a really good job. And in fact, the proportion of total numbers of retractions in terms of the number of papers published is still pretty small. But it can cause an awful lot of trouble, not only to the communities which rely on the veracity of our journal articles, but it's also getting out into the public domain. But what has that got to do with reproducibility? What several people have talked about already in this session is the belief, the knowledge that we can trust our science, we can trust our scientists and policymakers to act on accurate, reproducible, and cumulative knowledge. Everybody knows that. Do we have it? Don't know. The reasons for retractions, again, are pretty much intuitive to anybody who works in the field. They include misconduct, and they include honest error, one of which is irreproducibility. We've heard some examples of that, some challenges of that already this morning, so I'll rush through this. In terms of the discovery pathways, in this early stage, transitional stage, and in the transitional stage, is reproducibility an issue? Well, in 2011, science dedicated an issue of the journal to examining this and discovered that, particularly in light of the new technologies, and we just heard in the previous talk, a new technology which can generate enormous amounts of data, that we have challenges with coping with large databases. When I was starting, getting one bit of data took an enormous amount of time, and we cherished it and looked after it. Now we get enormous amounts of data, and the challenges associated with that, which will be talked about in the other parts of this conference, are huge. They raise expectations for new knowledge. Is that a good thing? In part, it is. However, it was flagged in this issue in the editorial that there's a need to convince not only the scientists, but also the public, and as we'll see, the policymakers, that this is relevant and important, and they used a separate issue, the one of climate change studies, to indicate how ropey this is and how interpretation, even of robust data, can be flawed. And it's not just in the science community, and it's not just with policymakers. Here, the really important people, the bankers, are paying attention to it. It's getting published in journals like the Wall Street Journal. And in fact, Reuters, the news agency, described how Amgen, in a heroic effort to validate, to reproduce in their own laboratories, over 50 landmark publications, things that we would read and take as gospel, if you like, they were able to replicate only 47 out of 53. They could not replicate the original studies. Baird did a similar thing, as was published in New Scientist, and joint activity leading to a clinical trial for an Alzheimer's drug was found to be flawed. And when an analysis was made, the original publication, which was published in The Lancet, could not be reproduced. If they found that out a little bit earlier, they would have saved not an awful lot of time, but an awful lot of money. So a review this year has analysed different studies which report the prevalence of irreproducibility. So what we have here is the percentage of irreproducibility in different studies, a few I've talked about. Isn't it ironic that they all get different values? None of them get a value less than 50%. Oops, what does that mean? The primary causes, actually, you talk to anybody over coffee, if you ever get to coffee. Poorly controlled experiments, rush to publish articles, insufficient sample sizes. This is a really nice little report, which actually talks to people. Why did that happen? Why did you let yourself get to that state? It's quite an honest report. And again, no surprises. And the nice thing about that is, it's easy to fix, or it's easy to maybe anticipate. The costs, if we take the US annual preclinical research spend, that's about $56 billion. If half of that is reproducible, that's great, we can go and do our work. If half of it is irreproducible, for different reasons, and again, this is reviewed by Friedman, then that's an awful lot of money. Half of that half could keep my lab running for years. But half of that would be irreproducible. So the discovery pathways, what's going on here? We have these three. This is where we get the crashes. We get the real bad things happening. Why? Widely publicized examples include these three clinical applications which went wrong because of discrepancies between their utility when they actually got into clinic and their utility in the real world. That's what I called where the rubber hits the road. And it seems that benefit-harm assessments at the time of market entry And so the company's going to recoup all the enormous expense it's made to get there, are not predictive. And that relates to some of the things being discussed here. And one feature, which I think gives some insight into this, is that early studies tend to yield exaggerated drug effects. And the earlier the study, the greater the claim. So if we go through our three phases, at the early stage, people publish papers and can make outrageous statements that kinase X, if targeted by a thiol group, will cure cancer. And that gets into the newspapers, and everybody thinks, Dr. X is wonderful! And unfortunately, patient groups get disaffected by that. So that's an issue. Do we have a responsibility about claim making at an early stage? Having done that, the next enormously expensive stage is to get traction on a development plan, this translational phase that I described. It's enormously expensive. So who are we going to get that money from? It could be any form of stakeholder. It could be government, funding agencies, or stockholders of corporations and venture capitalists. Would you ever tell them a lie about you? No. So, yeah, there's a degree of optimism here, maybe less than here because of due diligence, which does come in. But does it lead to stage three? No, that's where the train smashes occur. And that really is where the regulatory authorities kick in. That's where they do their role. But in fact, what Morris had introduced this session with was the notion that Pereri, among others, is trying to get regulatory authorities involved much further back along the pipe. And I think if that's done right, it'll be a healthy thing. Practice guidelines, so when you go to the doctor and you get your bills, they're actually working to integrate your formulation algorithms based on guidelines, which ideally should be brief and based on evidence. But if you analyze the guidelines, there's an inverse correlation between the length of the guideline and the level of evidence that's available. The level of evidence, it's a talk of its own, I'd be very happy to give it. It can be done also in 5 minutes. The guideline evidence is pathetically flawed, and it includes expert evidence where the definition of the expert is the person who wrote it. How do we close the gap? It's simple. If we accept that clinical research and development has been broadly fragmented, but yet emphasize clinical utility, that is, would you or your loved one go down this path or be the recipients of what you're telling the grant authorities that we can do, then producers, industry and researchers, regulators, end users, including patients and healthcare decision makers, people in this room, people at this conference, need to get together. And we're seeing examples of how that could be done, and in a particularly exciting way, using the same approach that people have achieved for massive, large-scale databases and arrays, we can actually get a way of thinking which can accommodate some of these complexities. It's not difficult to get a series of cures for this. Lots of people have done it. The writer, the author of the original bomb, if you like, about irreproducibility or crisis in research, has done this. And again, it's pretty straightforward. There's no rocket science, because rocket scientists have to do this too. But it's relatively straightforward, and if we pay attention to it, we'll be in a better place. So very briefly, that's all I have to say, apart from the fact that pay attention to detail, talk to each other, and everything will be tickety-boo. Thank you.